Mike, you wrote about DeGrom and hard luck, which puzzles me. That I know it's happening in the real world. The Mets aren't getting him runs. He's 0-1. He doesn't give up any runs. He strikes everybody out. Mets don't score runs at the same time. So I guess it is happening, and if it frustrates him, it is happening, right? But you went the W route, Mike? Really?
Hey, he's given up one run in his two starts, and he's got zero wins. What a bum.
I guess we should point out, Mike, there was a time where if a guy was like DeGrom, it would be said, there would be things about, yeah, but can the guy really win? Whereas we're way past that, and yet I'm recognizing it still is kind of a thing. He feels it. The Mets feel it, right?
Oh, absolutely. Listen, the funniest thing I think I've seen so far is in his two starts, he's got three hits. No other member of the Mets, the real actual hitters, have more than two hits. So he's not getting any luck. But like you said, I looked into this, right? Like, Mets fans are frustrated, and I wanted to know, could we quantify this? Is he really getting killed in this way that nobody else has? And the answer is almost. What I did was I looked up game score, right? Which I'm sure you're familiar with. It's an old Bill James metric where for every game, it looks at number of innings and strikeouts and runs and so on. And it puts a number from roughly 0 to 100 on the quality of the game. And so I looked up every pitcher in history who'd thrown at least 100 games with a game score of 60, right? So like 100 games that were considered to be very good. This is the highest percentage of games of these very good games where the pitcher ended up with a loss or a no decision. These are over 300 pitchers who've done it 100 times, and only one man has done it more than DeGrom. Wow. That's Jose De Leon. Now, remember, these guys aren't completing their games. They're not finishing things like they were, you know, back in the day, so they're leaving a little more to chance. But Mets fans, if you think he's really getting unfairly killed by this, you are right. He definitely is.
Have you showed this to Ron Darling yet? Because he'd be interested to know this. He made the list. Look at that.
I tweeted that, and I saw like six people tweet it to at Ron Darling. So I'm sure he sees.
If I run into him, he was here this morning. I'll have to run into him, let him know he's on that list. He's like, I knew I had some more wins coming your way. It is amazing. I remember Randy Johnson went through this where it just wasn't getting any wins. He wasn't giving up any runs. You figure it evens out. But since 2018, I'm being told the Mets are 36-42 in DeGrom starts. 36-42 in his starts, and he has a 2.06 ERA. Yeah, I don't know if that's happened in the history of baseball.
He's started 78 games the last 4 years, 46 of them. So more than half, he's allowed one run or zero runs. I know you, more than anybody else, have been trying to kill the win for years, and I don't think anybody has been more successful at doing that than Jacob DeGrom and the Mets.
Yeah, no, it's just not an issue, except it is happening in real time. I recognize that. Aroldis Chapman, what are you seeing with him early on?
Yeah, this is a guy who's been around for over a decade now. Relievers don't usually last this long at such a high of a level. And when you looked at him last season, his fastball velocity was at a career low. Now, 97 miles an hour for most guys is pretty good, but for him, it's a career low. And what did he do at the end of the season? Out of nowhere, he invented a new split-fingered fastball, and he's continued it on into this year, and it's been really good. He has thrown it 10 times across the last two regular seasons. 8 of those times he's gotten a swing and miss. It's really unfair that he can just invent this new pitch, and now he's pairing it with the fastball, which is back up to 99, and he's throwing it less than ever. Like, this is a great example of a guy who for years just got by on throwing 102 all the time. He can't do that anymore. He still throws very hard, but now he's got a good slider and a good out-of-nowhere split-finger fastball. He's got a strikeout rate of nearly 80% this year. Somehow this might be the best version of Chapman we've ever seen.
Mike, at the top of the show, I did a little essay on Will Myers and Byron Buxton. Can we believe in their breakout? What have you found with Myers? What are your thoughts on him?
I'm pretty in on Will Myers. You know, it's funny, people forget with all the stars on that San Diego team last year, he had the highest OPS plus, better than Tatis or Machado. It was Will Myers. And he's done something pretty interesting to start this year. He is really a guy I look at when I think of improved plate discipline. Really, the Padres as a team, I look at that. But he has dropped his chase rate by 10 percentage points. Last year, he was at 25%. You can see it was up near 29% a couple years ago. So far this year, 15%. Now, that's a big deal for every hitter in baseball, right? But it's specifically a big deal for him because if you look at him over the last few years, what happens in the zone versus out of the zone, as you can see, some great takes here. I know you love great takes. Inside the zone, he slugs over 550. Outside the zone, he slugs 265. It's the easiest thing to say is like swing at the good pitches and lay off the bad pitches. Yeah. It's the hardest thing to do, and he's doing a great job.
There are some quality takes in that rip we just showed right there. I mean, just going right off the plate, but you lay off those, and they've got to come into you. Mike, great stuff as usual. Thank you so much for joining us.